Good morning, United Methodist Women. I appreciate this invitation, and I am very honored to join all of you this morning for this very meaningful discussion about soul care, self-care, and care for others. But first, let us go before the Lord in prayer. Please pray with me. Gracious and loving God, maker of heaven and earth, ruler of time and space, we know you are with us, even in this virtual setting. And that is why we bless you at all times, good or bad. We praise your name, and it will continually be in our mouths. And so we thank you for this new day, for your guidance, and for your faithful servants who serve behind the scenes, working the technology that has allowed us to gather in your name, for your spirit which connects all of our hearts, for the global ministry of the United Methodist Women, for their mission to equip women and girls to be leaders and to work for justice through service and advocacy. We ask that you bless our time together, and that with all I say and all I do, your name will be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, letter writing is nearly a lost art. At least that's how I interpret it. Some of today's emails and texts and instant messages pale in comparison to the eloquent introductions that begin some letters that we find in Scripture. Even some of the emojis that we insert into our communications fall short of conveying our heartfelt emotions. Take this introductory verse from a scripture in 3 John chapter 2, verse 2. The scripture says, "I wish above all things that you will prosper, you will be in good health, even as your soul prospers." Now for me, the closest I usually come to that sentiment is, "I wish all the best for you." But as I read this verse, what really struck me was the writer's concern for some of the most essential aspects of our being, the condition of our health and of our soul. You know, Jesus once said, "What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul?" Our souls and our health work hand in hand because good health is essential to our physical well-being. The soul care is essential to our health. Last year at this time, I was very overweight, and the state of my health was seriously at risk. My blood pressure was borderline. My doctor was monitoring it closely. I was eating all the wrong things at all the wrong times. My activity was stagnant, and my exercising was minimal. But I became serious about taking some necessary steps. And from that day to now, I've lost 44 pounds. I'm still on a journey. I'm journeying toward better health. But the lessons I learned along the way are invaluable. Soul care is an essential component to good health. A healthy mind, a healthy outlook, a healthy perspective about life, all contribute to the condition of our overall health. You see, in addition to making healthier decisions, I began the year reading a new book, Fit Through Faith by Charlie Jordan Brookins. The author described her program as the intersection between faith, food, and fitness, the bridge to an essential gap between faith and whole body fitness. Our Bishop Cynthia Moore Kakoi recommended the book to me, and I'm very grateful. So I began using the scriptures as a daily devotion. But then I took it a step further by regarding each meal as an additional devotion, a devotion to God throughout the day. For more mindful eating, I meditated on the fact that we are all fearfully and wonderfully made. We have been given by God everything that pertains to life and godliness from the time that God created us in the divine image and said it was good. From the time God gave life to all creation. And so before eating, I was reminded to be thankful, but also to confess the sin of overeating, my own overeating, and the sin of not practicing the best self-care that I should and could. Also, before eating, I asked the Holy Spirit to give me the strength to walk in the victory that was already given when I put the prayer before God. And so I claimed the future victory that God had already provided for me at the end of this journey. I attended to the state of my soul. And now I know that soul care is essential even to my health, because it's not always about what you're eating, but about what's eating you. It's not always about what can be seen on the plate, but what is hidden in the recesses of our hearts and our souls. Overt and covert racism, sexism, and the like. We can't digest all of the troubles and the trials and the tribulations that this world has to offer. We can't do that and maintain a healthy soul. As you reflect on yesterday, ask about the state of your relationship with the Creator. It's an indicator of the state of your soul. As good Methodists, we are always moving toward perfection. And we know that people can't easily digest a diet of hurtful encounters, hurtful news reports, violent television images. We have to step back and ask, did I find ways to express my love and appreciation to all of the people that I encounter in spite of what I've been hearing or reading or experiencing? Soul care is essential to our health. And so I would invite you to step back and guard your eyes and your ears and your hearts. Do what you believe is most helpful for your health. Don't repress hurtful feelings. And don't try to forget pains associated with life. But try to become more intentional about caring for your soul. I also believe that soul care is essential to our heritage as believers. I mean, think about the season that is coming before us. Thanksgiving is a time of the year when our minds gravitate to our family members, those from the past and those in the present. What is your current unique sense of identity? What aspects and values and traditions and faith can be handed down to the next generations of your family? As members of God's family, the heritage of our faith has been handed down for thousands of years. It is the primary reason that we are able to connect with each other today, as sisters, as brothers, as believers, as children of God. And so it is an essential aspect of our lives to pass down the faith now and to preserve it for the generations to come. This Old Testament text from Deuteronomy 11:18 through 20 describes one perception about what God said should be done. And it reads like this: Therefore you shall impress these words of mine on your heart and on your soul, and tie them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as bands, frontals, frontlets on your forehead. You shall teach them diligently to your children, impressing God's precepts on their minds and penetrating their hearts with God's truth. Speaking to them when you sit in your house and when you walk along the road, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall write them on your doorpost of your house and on your gates. It is essential to be intentional about passing down the heritages of our faith to others, but we can only do it when we have properly cared for our very own souls. We can't describe to someone else the value of maintaining a relationship with God if we've been haphazard about attending to our own care. Now, I know it's not part of our culture today to walk around with the tradition of frontlets and decorative bands that our Orthodox counterparts use. But as a believer, we should take good care to impress God's words on our own heart and soul, and to do it in ways that work best for us as individuals, so that it will become an essential part of our lives and the part that will be passed down. Not passed down in any condition, but passed down in good condition. Something that someone else may be able to inherit. 4 years ago, I spent 6 weeks in Zimbabwe for a cultural immersion experience. And it was beautiful to become part of a tradition that resembled to me how faith was passed down in Jesus' time. United Methodist women were hosting weekly meetings from house to house, and they did this every Wednesday. Sometimes they needed to do it by candlelight, but always they were singing, they were praying, and they were testified about God's goodness. These women were planting seeds of faith for the next generation to take hold of. The faith is passed down one generation at a time, one family at a time, one person at a time. It is essential for each of us to maintain healthy souls so that the heritage of our faith will continue and will remain strong. 1 John 1 verse 1 says it like this: "The word which gives life, he existed from the beginning. We have heard him, we have seen him with our eyes, we have contemplated him, we have touched him with our hands." When I read these words, I can almost sense the excitement and conviction of this believer's experience with Jesus. A conviction that is impressed deep into the soul translates seamlessly from one generation to the next. It is a conviction that is solid enough to establish a strong personal witness so that our ancestors will continue to proclaim, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." I believe soul care is also essential to our hope. When people are attentive to the condition of their soul, they are constantly reminded about where to place their hope. Now, we all know there are many different things that we can hope for, but all believers have one hope in common. It is a hope in their eternal future. I want to mention one such person to you. So there was a lady by the name of Mary Jane Jenny Bain Wilson. And that's how her name is written in history. And I believe they probably referred to her as Jenny. So I'll take the privilege of doing the same. She was a songwriter. She was a poet. She was a laywoman in the church. But she was also confined to a wheelchair most of her life. Now, she could have focused all her hope on improved health, and no one would have blamed her. She could have written about her lifelong hope in the things of this world. But instead, she wrote words like this: "Build your hope on things eternal. Hold on to God's unchanging hand." And her song went on to say, "Do not covet this world's vain riches that so rapidly decay. Seek to gain the heavenly treasures. They will never pass away. When your journey is completed, if to God you have been true, fair and bright the home in glory your enraptured soul will view. Friends, we are most true to God when we attend to the condition of our souls. We are most connected when we place our hope in the Lord. According to 1 Peter 1, verses 3 and 4, this is our eternal hope. God has caused us to be born again in a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for each of us. And also, according to Philippians 3, verse 20, our citizenship is in heaven. And from that eternal hope, we wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We all know that one day we came naked into this world, and we were presented at that time to a room full of doctors and nurses and parents and friends. And someday, when we return to the Lord, all we can take back with us is the naked condition of our souls. Our greatest hope should be that it will be returned before God in the most favorable condition possible. And that can only happen when we take proper care to be attentive to our soul. And so as we transition into the upcoming memorial service, I ask that you will take this thought along with you. Even though we already miss those who have journeyed home ahead of us, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 says, we won't mourn like others who don't have any hope. Instead, I ask that you allow your mind to think on these things. Remember a glimpse of how their lives were lived before you. Consider how it reflected their intentional relationship with God. Remember possibly a gift of teaching or music. Remember how she shared her hospitality or her service. Think about her love and her compassion, even her joy. And as you reflect further on the lives that are no longer with us, take another moment and imagine the most precious part of their existence, a soul well nurtured and now resting in the arms of our Almighty God. In Jesus' name.
and forth by God's blessing, our true faith confessing, the people of God from this dwelling take leave. The service is ended, oh, now be extended, the fruits of our worship in all who believe. The seed of our teaching, receptive our teaching, shall blossom in action for God and for all. God's grace did invite us, and love shall unite us to work for God's realm and to answer the call. With praise and thanksgiving to